For almost 100 years, in big cities with 100 skyscrapers and tiny towns with one stoplight, on college campuses and Native American reservations, and churches too many to count, hundreds of thousands of men and women and boys and girls have made hundreds of thousands of life-changing decisions. Almost none of them knew her name, and yet she was there. Annie Armstrong lived more than 100 years ago. Only this one picture of her survives. History could have easily forgotten her, but Annie Armstrong is worth remembering. In the late 1800s, when most women had no voice, Annie was one of the first to speak up. First, for the urban poor in her hometown of Baltimore, and then for Southern Baptist missionaries around the world who desperately needed support. It was for these people that she helped start the National Woman's Missionary Union. As its first executive leader, she gave women a platform in their local church and in ways that they'd never done before. These women helped focus Southern Baptist attention on the hurting and the lost and the missionaries trying to reach them. Annie wrote letters, 18,000 in just one year, and she traveled across America, encouraging missionaries and inspiring churches to pray, to give, and to act. She worked long hours, paid her own expenses, and refused to accept a salary. And in the darkest days of the Depression, right before she died, an offering was named after her. Today, the Annie Armstrong Easter Offering helps missionaries in the U.S. and Canada start new churches and meet needs through Compassion Ministries. Over the years, Southern Baptists have given more than $1 billion to that offering, and 100% of it, every penny, has gone straight to the mission field. There's still work left to do. The need is bigger than ever, and that's why, even though she lived more than a century ago, and even though only one picture of her survives, Annie Armstrong's influence lives on. Because today in North America, just as it's been from the beginning, anywhere a missionary is sent, every time a new church is born, anytime someone gives to her offering so that a lost person might be found, Annie is there.
They see him here.
They see him here.
And they see him here.
We know it because he said it.
Jesus said, "The world will see him when the world sees us."
That's why together we do this.
We give so that those who've not yet seen can see.
It means something when the world sees how we give.
It means something because we do not look the same.
It means something because we do not sound the same.
It means something because when we give, this is what the world sees.
They see the gospel doing what the world cannot.
They see the gospel making us one. And so we give.
We give so that missionaries can go.
We give so that churches can be started, hurts can be healed, and truth can be shared.
We give so the world might see Jesus in us,
united as one.
Good morning, everyone. You guys don't sound sure that it's a good morning, but it's going to be 70 degrees today on March the 26th, and the sun's going to be out. After raining for what seemed like 40 days and 40 nights, but it was only one day and one night. I can't imagine 40. So if you would stand with us today, Andre had a little procedure done earlier in the week. He's recovering. I was out of town last week, so Trey's the drummer 2 weeks in a row. If he keeps doing this, he'll be the drummer every week. So three times and you're stuck, right? So we're glad to have you. As you know, anytime I lead worship, it sounds just a wee bit different than what Andre does. So We hope you enjoy and appreciate the variety that we offer here. So let's sing. We're going to start with Are You Washed in the Blood of the Lamb? Are you ready, John Montgomery?
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, are they white? Blood of the Lamb. Are you waking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are you spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When the bridegroom cometh, will your robes be white? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for those mansions bright? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless, are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Washed in the blood of the Lamb.
It's me again. Oh, it's Joe. He's coming up. All right, I thought I had to do the welcome. Estelle hired me, but you're the man. No, you're the man. You ain't got nothing else to say today. You can do the welcome. Here he comes, ladies and gentlemen, is Mr. Joe Wagner.
Can you hear me? Oh, there we go. Well, let's say a word of prayer. Let's pray. Lord God, we come to you this morning. We're grateful to be here in this place and worship you. Lord, we ask that you speak to our hearts today and that you use the music and you'll use your word to draw people to yourself, Lord, and that the end that some may be saved this morning even. Lord, so we just ask for that and we pray for your spirit to move. And we pray this in your name. Amen. Hey, if you would, go ahead and have a seat. Hey, glad you're with us this morning. It's good to see you. I don't know if you saw these, a lot of people you were visiting and having a good time, but we did show a video. And what we do is twice a year we take up a special offering. One is for foreign missions, and we call that the international mission. We call it Lottie Moon. And then we do another mission around Easter called the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. And our goal is like $3,000. And what we do is that goes to plant churches here in North America. And, you know, I used to think we didn't really need that many missionaries in the United States. But I don't know, if you turn on the news these days, we might need some missionaries here. What do you think? So all that money goes, and there's not a penny of it that doesn't go towards helping start churches and help church plants and so forth in America and North America. So pray about what you'd give and what God would have you give, and then give towards that. There's special offering envelopes for that. Say Annie Armstrong on it. All right. Now, I'll just say this to set it up. So I guess it was Monday. I started losing my voice on Sunday, and Monday I was pretty bad, and then Tuesday I didn't have any voice, and Wednesday, and Christy said, amen. And Thursday, I went to the doctor on Monday, and the antibiotics started to kick in a little bit, but I was scared I wasn't still going to be able to talk. And so you guys are going to have a treat today, because Brother Jim's going to come and share with us in a little bit. And I heard his sermon in the first sermon. He did a good job. So you'll be blessed with Brother Jim this morning. And we are blessed here because we have several people that can sing and lead and so forth. And so we got Keenan Rice this morning because Andre had a surgery on Monday. And Keenan does a good job, doesn't he? And we appreciate him. Hey, just a couple announcements. One, after this service, maybe you may have already seen this, but in the FLC, the Family Life Center, there is the youth are going to youth camp this summer in June, and they're trying to raise some money to go to youth camp. And so there's all kinds of treats down there. Anything in particular, item that's, what do you got, Matt?
I'll talk about it after service.
Okay, after the service to make you hungrier. So anyways, you'll want to do that because you won't have to make dessert or go to Dairy Queen or anything today because there'll be, what?
No Dairy Queen.
No Dairy Queen. All right, so we've got that going on after this. And let me just tell you a couple other things. So we're 2 weeks out from Easter. And that is a time that you can ask someone to come to church. And they may tell you no any other time besides like Christmas and Easter. And so this 2 weeks away, you'll notice on the sides here, we've got these cards. And they say Easter on them. And they're just like invitation cards. And if you know someone, maybe you work with or some your neighbor, you know, or a friend, pick one of those cards up and let's invite somebody. And let's try to triple our attendance that day. That'd be great. We usually have a really good attendance that day anyways. But you know what? I'd like to have standing room only. How about you? Be great. Yeah. So pray about that and ask the Lord who you should invite and get one of those cards and give it out. All right. Also, the Thursday before Easter, we're going to have a little special time here where we just do the Lord's Supper, and we're going to do communion that night at 6 o'clock, Thursday night before Easter. It'll be right in here. It'll be a short service where we're just going to focus on what Jesus did on the cross for you and I and just kind of celebrate what he did. So just mark that down. That'll be, I believe it's April 6th, all right? Now, at this time, here's what I want you to do. Thanks for being here. I'm glad you're with us this morning. And would you stand again? Look at those right around you. Give them a high five, a shake, holy kiss, a hug, whatever you want to do.
Holy kisses.
Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare dare not trust a seated frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. When darkness seems to hide its face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. His oldest covenant, His blood, so poured me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, He then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground. You breathe in the air, you shine in. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do. Every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a
for bringing us here today. And we don't show enough gratitude, probably not even one of us in here, and we just have so much to be thankful for. Even the simple things of being able to wake up and get something out of a refrigerator to eat, to be able to travel without people, you know, stopping us from traveling, to be able to come to church and worship here without fear of a, a government or another party coming in and attacking us. We are very free in America, and we have a lot to be thankful for here. For you, especially in the price your son paid on the cross to give us eternal life, that is something that there aren't words. There aren't words that could say to show gratitude for that. And we just want to pause here a moment and show gratitude and tell you how much that we know what you've done for us, and we appreciate it and we cherish that. And I hope I never get to where I take that for granted. I hope I never get to where I have pride in that, because there's just nothing that I have or nothing that I can do to make me suited to be anywhere near you. But we appreciate what you've done for us, and we thank you for the sacrifice of your son. And we ask you to have your hand on this service and your hand on every single thing that Brother Jim comes up here and talks about today. And I hope the people who you want to hear are here, and I hope they hear what you want us to hear, and that's me included, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. I hope you're having a good morning. Children's church. Children's worship, you're ready to go. I asked Chris to put this stool on the platform for me this morning. Not because of my arthritis, although that is a problem for me. I want us to begin. I want to begin with a story. And I want it to be sort of an intimate thing. I sort of thought about it like a fireside chat, but I couldn't talk Chris into starting a fire, so we're going to tell this story, and I want you to get involved in the story, and I want you to identify with one of the two characters that are involved in the story. In fact, I'm pretty sure you will identify with one or the other. It's about two men that are in the hospital. Their names are John and Bill. Now, because it's two men doesn't mean it couldn't be youth or a couple of ladies or a mixed group. It could be anyone. But I want you to identify with either John or Bill. Both of them are dying. They're in the hospital ward, and they're placed in the back of the wing. They're in a room because there's nothing they can do for them except make them comfortable. The two of them are together. They're in this room. They've been friends for a while, not really super friends. They've just been friends. They see each other in the community, and they exchange pleasantries and so on and so forth. But John and Bill know each other, and John has been trying to witness to Bill for a long time. Now, John is a member of a church that he has been active in. He's been working in this church as a teacher and several other things. He's where he gives his tithes, and he's been doing this for quite a long time. He's an evangelical Christian and tries to share the message that Jesus saves with everybody. And he's tried this before with Bill, and Bill has always said, I really don't need this. But here they are in the hospital room, both of them dying. They know they're going to die within a day or two. And John says to Bill once again, "Do you know where you're going when you die? Do you know where you're going from here?" And Bill says, "Well, I've thought about some of that, but I understand that you're going to share the message of Jesus with me, and I understand that, but I've decided a long time ago he was a good prophet and so on and so forth, but I'm just not buying this Son of God thing. John says, well, you really need to think about it because we're both dying. It's not going to be long for us before we move into eternity. Bill says, let's talk about something else. So Bill kind of shuts John down. And they go on. John's a gentleman, and he goes on and talks about something else. And within a day or two, both of them have died. Now, John will tell you that in his hospital bed, when he was about to die, he saw heaven open. He saw the angels. And they came for him. And they picked him up and took him into heaven. And he's busy talking to people that have gone on before, talking to his friends and relatives and so on and so forth. And he's beginning to acclimate to the colors and the just a wonderful, I mean, you can't describe what heaven is like. And he's sort of acclimating to it. And I don't know if we still can communicate from hell to heaven. We're going to see in the story that Jesus told in just a few minutes that we can. Many of you have heard this story before. But at least at this point in time, let's just assume that you can. And Bill looks up and he sees John in heaven. And he gets John's attention. And he said, man, this is terrible. This place really is bad. I'm in such torment. It's just, I can't stand it. And yet it goes on. And John says, Bill, I'm really sorry for you. Bill says, well, I'm trying to make some points here so I can get out of here and so on and so forth. And once again, John says to Bill, there's no way to get out of there. You're going to be there forever. You're going to be there for eternity. And I'm sorry for that. Bill says, oh, no, there's got to be a way to work my way out of here. I got to make some points and get out of this place. And once again, John says, it's forever. Eternity. It's forever. And Bill, you're going to be there for eternity. Now, here's the bottom line with what I want to say this morning. I want you to identify with either John or Bill, because you're just like one of them. Maybe you've already made a decision to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you're like John. When your time comes, you're going to heaven. But if you're here this morning and you haven't made that decision, and if you've been putting it off, today is the day of salvation. Because you see, hell is forever. And when you die, you're either going there or you're going to be with Jesus. You're going to heaven. Perhaps just as important, maybe you're here and you've made that decision and you're feeling good about it and so on and so forth. What about your friends? What about your family? What about others, of those around you? Have they made that decision? Maybe you should talk to them about it, because you see, hell is forever. I've been trying to wrap my head around that. God's been talking to me about this for the last 4 or 5 months. And it's not that I don't know all of this beforehand. He suddenly impressed on me, have you really considered forever? Have you really thought about it's for eternity? And I'm still wrapping my head around that. And I'm still thinking about my family and friends and people I've talked to before and so on and so forth. But that's where I am this morning. I want to share with you the reality of hell. I want to share with you how important it is, because if you go there, it's for eternity. Now, there are many people who do not believe in the reality of hell. They laugh it off. They make fun of it with jokes and cartoons. There are even some Christians who sort of laugh that off. Let me give you an example of an extreme one. There's a guy by the name of Gordon Kaufman, who is a professor at Harvard Divinity School. He's supposed to be teaching our future preachers and such. And here's what he said. I don't think there can be any future for heaven and hell. After all, we're in the 21st century, and we're smart enough to know that, you know, those things just don't exist. Those things are not present for us. Now, admittedly, hell is an unpleasant topic. Unbelievers disbelieve it. Most Christians ignore it. Even the staunchly biblical diehards are often silent out of embarrassment. But hell, more than any doctrine in the Bible, seems to be out of step with our times. We don't talk about it much. The reason that God got me started on this a couple, 3 months ago about the eternity of hell is because over and over again, as a preacher, I've been told, you guys don't preach about hell enough. It's an unpleasant subject. It's something we just don't really want to get all involved in. But it's real. And it's important. Jesus said more about hell than heaven. Let me give you another quote. This is from Edwin Letzer in a little book called 1 Minute After You Die. He said, for years, liberal scholars taught, and some sentimentalists still do, that Christ, who stressed the love of God, could never be party to the doctrine of hell. Yet significantly, of the 12 times the word Gehenna is used in the New Testament, 11 times it came from the mouth of our Lord. Indeed, he spoke more about hell than about heaven. That's a fact. Now, Gehenna and Hades and hell, those are all interchangeable terms. You can look up the Greek on those and the Hebrew on that, and you will find that they're interchangeable terms. So this morning, I want you to turn over to Luke, the 16th chapter. Luke 16. And I want to read to you, and I want you to follow along, a story that Jesus told. In Luke 16, starting with the 19th verse, there was a rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen, and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate was laid a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who desired to be fed with what fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, even dogs came and licked his sores. The poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. And in Hades, being in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus at his side. And he called out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in anguish in this flame." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that you in your lifetime received your good things, and Lazarus in like manner bad things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in anguish. Besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been fixed, in order that those who would pass from here to there may not be able, and none may cross from there to us." And he said, "Then I beg you, Father, to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, so that they may be warned, lest they also come into this place of torment." But Abraham said, "They have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them." And he said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent." He said to him, "If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone should rise from the dead." Pray with me for just a second. Father, thank you for your grace. And thank you for your word. And I ask you, Lord, now to just lead and guide in what we're going to see here. And in this very brief time, Father, I ask you to just touch our hearts, walk among us by your Spirit, and teach us. Teach us, Father, what you want us to see and what you want us to hear. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Now, I want you to know right up front that I believe that this story is a fact. If you take a look at many of the commentators, I have, I don't know, hundreds on our computer. We've got all kinds of commentators and all kinds of Bible translations and so on and so forth. If you take a look at all the commentators, most of them will tell you this is a parable. But it's not. It's a story of fact. It's a story that Jesus told. Notice how he starts out here. "There was a rich man." That's very clear. He didn't say, "I want to tell you a parable." He didn't say, "I want to share something with you that's like a metaphor that I want you to understand." He said, "There was." Now, there are a lot of people that don't believe that. But if you look at all the translations, the New English translations, the ones that are good. You know, it could be the King James, the NASB, it could be ESV, the CSB, just on and on. All of them use the same language. There was. So this is a story of fact. If this is a parable, this would be the only parable that Jesus called a person by name. And he names two of these guys. Now, he says the rich man, and a lot of commentators and others have named him Dives, because Dives is the Greek for rich man. But we find this a story about the rich man and a man named Lazarus. It's really the same story as Bill and John. One of them went to heaven, and one of them went to hell. Now, this is prior to, Jesus told this story prior to his death and resurrection. So what we need to understand here is that in Old Testament times, or prior to the crucifixion and resurrection, I want you to picture an oval. All right, an oval. And there's a line drawn down the middle. And over here on your right is a place called Abraham's bosom. That's how we've named it. And it is where the righteous dead from the Old Testament went to await the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. Now, if you don't believe that, look at Matthew 27, and you will see that when Jesus died and was resurrected, this whole place was emptied out. And they even walked among the people of Jerusalem. I don't understand all of that. I don't understand exactly how it works, but I do know that this was emptied out. But hell is still there. And every single person who dies without Jesus Christ as their personal Savior is going there. And it's for eternity. You see, that's my real problem. If I thought you could work your way out of that, I'd be joyous. But you can't. You can't. So the Bible supports the fact that the place that Jesus is referring to is a real reality. That's the bald truth about hell. If hell is not real, and if it is not for eternity, then the Bible is a lie. That's the bottom line here. So as proof of what I'm saying to you, I want you to see three things this morning. First, I want you to notice the principal characters here in this true story. It's important to see that there are real people involved here. And there are really three central characters, two of them that we've already really talked about, and two of them I want us to key on. There's the rich man, there's Lazarus, and there's Father Abraham. Father Abraham has been here for quite some time. But the rich man went to hell. Now I want you to think about this for a minute. You and I are rich. We could be this rich man. We could be this in this place. I told the first service I was thinking about how rich I am. I've got a few bucks in the bank, not much. But I'm sitting in my recliner, my feet are up, and the heat is on. Got a warm bed in the next room, roof over my head, don't care if it's raining, snowing, or whatever, don't really care. I've got three remotes next to me. My large flat screen is on, and I'm just sitting there being entertained. I'm rich. Now think about that for a few minutes. I've got a couple cars in the garage. I can go out and one of them, I push a button. One of them, I turn the key. And they just simply start up and take me wherever I want to go. I'm rich. I'm saying to you that all of us in this place today, most of us in this country today, are rich. We could be this rich man. So we see that there's three personages here, but two of them I want you to think about. Two of them, I want you to pick one and identify with. First is rich man, next one is the poor man. And Jesus calls him Lazarus. He names the individual. He didn't make up that name. He just simply said, there was. And that's what we see here. Now, there's some incidental characters that, you know, our brothers and Moses and the prophets and some others. But get a hold of this idea that there are at least two principal characters here. There's the rich man, there's Lazarus. But secondly, after you see the principal characters, I want you to notice the primary content here. The story is simple. The life of the rich man could be most of us. The life of the poor man, again, Jesus calls him Lazarus, and both of these people died. Lazarus went to Abraham's bosom. By the way, that's a place called paradise. That's where Jesus told the thief on the cross, "Today you'll be with me." Nobody could go to heaven yet because Jesus hadn't died on the cross and had been resurrected. But as soon as he was, that place emptied out. They went to heaven. And that's where they're going to be for eternity. That's where you will be. That's where I will be if we know Jesus Christ as our Lord. If we know that, know that Jesus is Lord, and we've given our life to him, then that's where we're going to be. So Lazarus went to Abraham's bosom. The rich man went to hell. And again, the terms Hades, hell, Gehenna, it's all used interchangeably. The rich man was in torment. Lazarus was in paradise. Their fate was sealed, and it couldn't be changed. Abraham said very clearly, "You guys over here can't go over there, and we can't go over there. It can't happen." So what was received and believed on earth is what determined the fate of each man. There never was, and there is not, a second chance. Don't let anybody tell you there's a second chance. That's not supported by Scripture, and is certainly not supported by Jesus. So everyone must pick what they want to do for eternity while they are here. Now, I've talked to a lot of people who said, "Yeah, but, you know, I'm young and virile. I got life by the tail, man. I'm doing good." Well, Friday night and Saturday, there were some people like that in Mississippi. Many of them were asleep, enjoying life, rich like I am. And suddenly, they were dead. They didn't know it was coming. They didn't think it was coming. They thought they'd live forever. And I suspect that that's many people in America today. There may be some people here in this congregation are like that, or maybe some people who are watching this particular program that think they've just got plenty of time. We have no clue. Please understand, we have no clue when our time is up. You can be as healthy as a horse, busy doing all kinds of stuff, and tonight you might be dead. I don't think we're going to have a tornado today, but I don't know that you won't have an automobile accident. I don't know that somebody won't pop through that door and start firing off a weapon. I don't know that. I don't know when my time is up, and neither do you. So the Apostle Paul says to the Thessalonian church, here's how I explain the context here. What he said was, when he, meaning God, when God takes vengeance with a flaming fire on those who don't know God and on those who don't obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, they will pay the penalty of eternal destruction. Now, the Thessalonian church was under persecution. That's why he wrote that. But notice what he said here. They will pay the penalty of eternal destruction. That's the primary content here. Understand, you'll make a decision. You may decide, "Oh, I'm tired of hearing all this stuff. I'm going to go on and just live my life." Well, you might do that, but you will die It is appointed unto man once to die. That's what Hebrews tells us. You will die. I will die. I'm closer to it than you are, I bet you. But we will die. And when we die, our fate for eternity is sealed. You're either going to heaven or you're going to hell. So it's easy to see the principal characters and the primary content. But I also want you to see a personal conclusion. You see, I want you to make that today. This is where the rubber meets the road. This is where it meets the road in your personal life. Do you identify with Bill or do you identify with John? Are you like the rich man or are you like Lazarus? This is a personal decision, in a sense that every person will make a personal decision. That may sound like I'm word salad, so to speak, but I just want you to understand that it's a personal decision that you have made or will make. It's important that you understand. Every person within the sound of my voice will make a decision. You may walk away and say, I'm not gonna have anything to do with it today. You could do that, but that's your decision. You will make a decision. So this personal conclusion should be based on the answer to two questions. Your personal decision should be based on the answer to two questions. The first question is, what really is hell? Well, let me read to you from Matthew, the 13th chapter. These are Jesus' words, by the way. As the weeds are pulled up and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will weed out of his kingdom everything that causes sin and all who do evil. They will throw them into the fiery furnace, where there will be a weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears, let him hear. He who has ears, let him hear. Now we know from our scripture reading, as we go back just a little bit, a couple of minutes ago, we know that hell is fiery torment. Hell is eternal because people are eternal. Matthew 25 said, and then they will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. Hell is a place not made for humans. That's not to say that humans won't go there. You see, Matthew 25 again says, then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. God never intended for any person to go to hell. You must step over the cross to get there. Can I say that again? You've got to step over the cross to get there. You've got to ignore Jesus and his sacrifice for you. 2 Peter says, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. So hell was created as a place for Satan and his angels. And by default, hell then becomes a place for those who reject Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. You got to step over the cross. You got to ignore it. You got to say, well, I don't really believe that happened. I can tell you from personal experience that God has shared with my heart that it was real. And I hope that applies to many of you. Hell is the destiny of lost souls. Now let me again read you some scripture. This is from Revelation 20. Then I saw a great white throne, and him who was seated on it. And earth and sky fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne. And books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what he had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. And hear this as we close this scripture. The lake of fire is the second death. If anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. So that answers this question of what hell is. And the second question is this: why do people go to hell? Why are they lost? Why do people have to spend eternity in a place away from God, in a place called heaven? Why do they have to do that? Well, God answers this same question. He said, I take no pleasure in the death of anyone. Repent and live. Pretty simple. So some people will go to hell because they do not believe that hell exists. Some will go to hell because they proclaim that God does not exist. Some will go to hell just because they ignore hell. Some people will go to hell because of the possibility that someone they love is already there. Now, if you think that, then you need to pay attention to what Jesus told in this story. Did you notice that the rich man said, well, send him to my brothers then, because I don't want them to come here. Some people will go to hell because someone they love is there. Some people will go to hell because they procrastinate. They put off a decision. Some people will go to hell because they love a certain sin or sins. John 3 says, this is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but men loved darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. Now, many people may think, and I've shared with you a number of reasons why people go to hell, but I want you to know there's really only one reason. There's only one reason why people go to hell. It's because they call God a liar. Now, I've talked to a lot of people who said, oh, I would never say that about Jehovah God. Let me read you a scripture from 1 John, because this really sums it up. Anyone who believes in the Son of God has this testimony in his heart. Anyone who does not believe God has made him out to be a liar, because he has not believed the testimony God has given about his Son. And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. So every individual will come to a personal decision about Jesus Christ. Every one of us will. You're doing it right now. You're doing it in the home. On that TV. You may be doing it in other places, but your mind may be wandering still. You will make that decision today. So here's the conclusion that's very simple. The good news is that if God grants you the desire to trust Christ, that you might escape hell, you are invited to do so. We read, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. Thankfully, there is a way of escape. We can be forever shielded from the wrath to come. You don't have to go to hell. You can go to heaven if you want. So the real question is this: where are you going to spend eternity? The choice really is yours. It's up to you. Where are your friends and your family going to spend eternity? The choice is up to you. Let me share kind of a silly illustration that draws all this together. There were two men who were sitting in a restaurant. They were arguing, and it was getting hotter and hotter. And finally, one man got so angry with the other guy that he jumped up and he said to him, "Go to hell!" There was a guy in the booth right next to him who tapped him on the shoulder. And he was a Christian reading his Bible. And he said to the guy after he tapped him on the shoulder, "I've been reading the directions, and you don't have to go if you don't want to." That's the bottom line. Hell is a terrible, eternal place. Where are you going when you die? Where are you going? The choice is yours. It's yours alone. What do you want to do? Where do you want to go? Where are you going when you die? Father, thank you for your grace. And thank you for today. And thank you for your word. Most of all, Father, I thank you for the salvation that you give us. And I thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to escape this terrible, terrible place that we call hell for eternity. Father, lead us and guide us in this invitation now. And Lord, as we open up this altar for people to pray, and as our pastor is here, willing to receive you, please make the right decision. Again, Father, we thank you for your grace. And we ask you to walk among us and touch us and teach us in this invitation time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Let's stand together. Our pastor is down here in front. He's willing to receive you. Please, if you have a decision to make, do it. You may simply want to come and pray. You may want to go to somebody. I don't know. But what I ask you to do is don't call God a liar. Jesus died for you.
I come to you, for I know you're satisfied. I am empty, but I know your love does not run dry. So I wait for you. So I
Got a couple announcements we want to go through. I'm going to have Matt come and share a couple things.
Yeah. So as Joe mentioned, we do have a bake sale going on. I'm going to be down in the FLC again right after this service. And even if you're going, I didn't know this was going on, or maybe I heard it one time and I forgot, I didn't bring cash with me. One of the things that you can do is you can come and get what you want, and then you can go online and give through our website directly to New Camp. If you go on there and you press the menu button and you go down to donate, and on there will be a specific, you can specifically pick to donate towards New Camp. That's 100% fine. I completely trust that. If you picked up some baked goods and you want to give online, that's 100% fine with me. With that being said, one of the things we're going to do is starting next week, I'm going to have a list of the names of students and leaders that we have going to New Camp. One of the things we're blessed with in our church is I talk to a lot of youth pastors that they fight tooth and claw to try to get people to fundraise. They've got to do a bunch of different stuff. One of the things we're blessed with in our church is more often than not, I just simply have people come up to me and go, hey, I just want to pay for a student. I want to pay for a couple of students. And that's awesome that our church goes, I don't want anything in return. I'm not looking for anything. I just want to be able to provide for those. So if you are interested, here's something I would like to do this year, that as you come and you give and you provide for a student, I'm going to give you a name. And one of the things that I'm going to have this list down here, so pick a name. You might not even know who they are, but pick a name if you want to give towards one of them. And one of the things that I'm going to ask our church to do the week before we go to camp is if you've sponsored a student, I'm going to give you a name or names, and I would like for you to write a note for them that they can take with them, that I'll hand out the Saturday morning we leave, that as they go, they'll have the name and just an encouraging note. Just, I'm praying for you as you go to camp, because it's so much more than just giving money, but it's an opportunity even now to be praying for these students, that as we get there, that we would be praying for what God's going to do in their lives during this time. The other announcement I have is, I've spoke about this once before, but next Sunday night, April 2nd, at 6 p.m. in this room, we're going to be having a worship night. Once again, it's nothing scripted. I've had people go, well, how long is it going to last? I don't know. It's you know what, if you're going to, you go, I've got 30 minutes, I can be here for 30 minutes and then leave. That's totally fine with me. It's going to be wide open. If you want to have your kids come and charge a tablet for them and they can sit there with their headphones on, that's 100% fine. It's not going to be a very churchy environment. It's not going to be a very strict, structured, nothing like that. It's not a youth thing. It's not a praise man thing. It's not a FBC church thing. I'm not putting it on Facebook, on Instagram. I'm not trying to advertise it at all. Our goal is just to simply have a night of just worship, however that looks like for you, whatever that looks like. But that'll be next Sunday night, 6 o'clock in this room. I think that's all I got.
It's funny you said not a very churchy environment, Matt. Everybody's waiting for the punchline now. Hey, every week I tell Matt, or I don't tell Matt, I should tell Matt, but I tell Andre, you know, we should be singing at the end of our service. We should go out of here singing, right? So if you guys could spare a couple more minutes, we're going to have one more song of worship. If you'd stand up, it might be not considered a very churchy environment like Matt said, but hey, we're going to have some fun. We want to see smiles on your faces, and we're very fortunate to be here and have ministers in our church, multiple people who can preach for us. So, hey, we're going to sing. Hope you guys don't mind. And then after that, Joe is going to preach for us. Joe, are you going to stand there the whole time?
I'm going to do an interpretive
movement. He's going to do an interpretive movement along with this. And then Joe is going to pray, and we're going to go down and empty our pockets at the youth bake sale. Who's going to empty their pockets at the youth bake sale? I got a few people. All right, good deal. Are you guys ready? Here we go. I gotta put everything in the right place.
Born to the darkness I was, rejected and cut out from hope. I couldn't see His love for me. They say He's not what He get your hopes up for healing, but the lies fell away when I saw His face. My heart burst to life, and I saw the light in His eyes when He looked at me. And my whole world's on fire, alive in the presence that burned inside of me. is the song that I sing. All of my days are filled with your praise. All of my days are filled with your praise. My heart burst to life, and I saw the light in his eyes when he looked at me. And my whole world's on fire, alive in the presence that burns inside of me.
Here and do this till everybody claps along, right? It's gonna get awkward. Even Joe's clapping back there.
No one could ever take my soul away. My eyes were open when I saw his face. No one could ever take away my faith. Changed the day that Jesus came. No one could ever take my song away. My eyes were open when I saw his face. No one could ever take away my faith. My life was changed the day that Jesus came. He looked at me, and my whole world's on fire, alive in the presence that burns inside of me. And I know whose I am, forever I'll stand in your truth, cause I believe that I was blind, but now I see. Yes, I was blind.
All right, we're going to close out today. Thank you again, Brother Jim, for speaking this morning. We appreciate you and Brother Kino for filling in for us today. All right, John is going to come. He's our Deacon of the Week, and he's going to close us out. God bless you. Have a great week.
Pray with me, please. Lord, we just are thankful. Thank you for this beautiful day, the building that you've allowed us to worship in. Lord, we thank you for your word and your truth. And most of all, your grace, Lord. We just ask that the Holy Spirit would continue to convict us and move us this week and just bring us back safely next week. Amen.